Hani Pham, Executive Vice President, Enterprise Partnerships of Mastercard. Brigitte Lull, Head of Amadeus for Destinations. Elisa Martin Garijo, and the Chief Technology Officer of IBM Spain. And Elena Gil, Global Director, Big Data B2B Telefonica. Andrea Voleta, where are you? Okay. We had, for personal reasons, the Undersecretary of Chile with us, unfortunately not with us right now. We excuse her, but we enjoy right now the discussion of that panel on what we are looking really after. The role of tourism in our changing societies. This is on the mindset of everybody. This is of the mindset of everybody attending these conferences. This big question mark, what does it mean technology for tourism? What does it mean for producing more sustainability, resilience in our societies? And in that context, I wish to address the Secretary of State with one first question, in Espanol.
Secretary. It's not your first day, it's this second week managing a portfolio of such an important sector in Spain. Tourism plays a key role in Spain. Tourism has always played a key role, in fact, in Spanish government's agenda. And now in your hands, what role does technology play? What role will technology play in managing in the smart management of Spanish destinations? Yes, please use the microphone. Well, good morning to all of you. Well, from the General Secretary of Tourism, technology will play a very important role. Technology, innovation, digitization of tourist destinations, intelligence. Well, I can say that data shows that from a tourist standpoint, there's a huge potential in our country, in this autonomous community, across our country, in fact. And all this data shows that is giving more opportunities for our destination, but also faces challenges and responsibilities, both for the government on three levels, the local, the autonomic, and the state government, as well as for the tourist companies. I think tour operators, and I think at this point it's very important to join forces and work together. The government at all levels with the representatives of the tourist sector, universities, etc. So together we can analyze, share knowledge, seek alliances in order to implement technologies across this field. It is essential that we implement new technologies in tourism. Why? Well, to continue to be a leader in world tourism, Spain as a tourist, as a destination, so we get real-time understanding of all the information, to be also closer to our visitors, to know them, in fact, before they come to our country. So we can modulate, where possible, our destinations and adapt our offering to their own needs, the changing needs of our visitors, and also to preempt the future, if I may say that. Smart tourist destinations is not just a trend, it is in fact a future. So we, as a tourist powerhouse, and we want to continue to remain a tourist powerhouse, so we are committed to continue to work with all sectors in order to delve deeper into this new trend and to go together along this path so that we can all develop sustainable tourism from a social, environmental, and economic point of view. If we don't address it from the standpoint, if it's not based on sustainability, naturally, it can lead to certain issues, problems. So all political parties, all stakeholders have to work together to develop 21st century tourism. The Secretary General earlier, during his speech, he was talking about sustainability as a competitiveness factor, underlining that in the future, transparency that technology will develop is going to help us not only analyze what we have, the data, but also for the customer to understand what to do. So that transparency in the future, do you agree, will improve the quality of the product, will improve the political commitment behind this, which ultimately we are going to show that, because this is what we're promising, because do you think this is going to contribute to sustainability? Absolutely. Because I think transparency also means participation, involvement in every way, in any way. Involvement of locals, of all the part of the stakeholders, and of tourists also, our visitors, with understanding the way we are, understanding our culture, our idiosyncrasy. So transparency also means participation, and participating in tourism is very important. Well, thank you very much.
I see you have a very long statement prepared, and I will discourage you from reading that statement.
Yeah.
We all know, Minister, that when you traveled the long way here, you said that you are curious, and we were really welcoming this statement, curious to learn what others have been doing. I would like to hear from you. What would you find the best takeaway from that conference? What would you tell me on Wednesday when I'm leaving that door with you? What have you learned? Can you formulate this wish, what you want to learn here, so that you as a responsible person can formulate something when you are coming back to Sri Lanka?
Thank you very much. First of all, I must thank the UNWTO for the Second World Congress, where you're discussing a very important subject of digitalization. And we in Sri Lanka deeply welcome this initiative, because for the last 2-3 years, we have been developing a large number of traffic of tourists to Sri Lanka, particularly in a world where over 1 billion people are crossing borders. This initiative is very important and useful in order to gather data or information, identification, and so many other initiatives being now made use of. We in Sri Lanka, recognize the national tourism organizations are embracing digital technology because it enables real-time interactive communication, which is far more advantageous than the brick and mortar model. This is the ultimate idea of digitalization. And particularly we in Sri Lanka, we are a developing country, not so much developed as any other countries in Europe. However, the increase in demand for tourism to Sri Lanka is very much more than what we expected. And therefore, these initiatives are very, very important in order to keep a track of what is taking place around the world as well as in our own country. And the idea is the digitalization is very much a work in progress, not only for us in Sri Lanka, but almost everybody in the world, mm-hmm. It's universal. That is something that we all realize. The government of Sri Lanka realizes the importance of smart technology, and for the first time, has appointed and dedicated a Minister for Digital Infrastructure. We have a separate ministry here back in Sri Lanka to ensure the smooth migration of government services in the digital platforms. So these are some areas that we are developing new in the new government, and as such, we need to keep abreast with what is happening in the rest of the world.
Minister, it's very honest what you are just saying, and I know that you will benefit especially as a country from the digitalization. That's why it's so important to put the finger at what we are actually talking about. Digitalization, what is it? Is it just to improve our competitiveness. We have here, during the conference, a wonderful case from Botswana, where we see what digitalization, satellite images are bringing to us, where the rest of the infrastructure normally is lacking, where we don't have these statistical offices which provide us with the necessary information to take informed decision and actually help us to jump ahead. Technology can help us to jump ahead of one step of the evolution and bring with the desired tourism development sustainability, engaging, as the Secretary of State just said, engaging with the local population. Do you have already the right partners there?
Once again?
Do you have already the right partners from the private sector in Sri Lanka? Okay. We have many private sector companies later on speaking and telling you what solutions they have. Do you have
We have quite a lot of companies which has now come up with the digitalization.
Yeah.
And the government make use of that concept for their own benefit. And that is one area that we are not a government-controlled economy, but public-private combination.
I thank you very much, and Minister Marcela Bacigalup. Es un placer de tenerla este año y...
It's a pleasure to have you here this year and to talk to you about your experience. And particularly, you have focused on your plan. You presented it last year. You have focused on conserving culture and heritage. Right now, in this year, would you please tell us what you've done over the course of this year? What experiences can you tell us about? What technology have you used? Good morning. We're very happy to be here today with you and to present our technology. 25 years, our 25th anniversary of the School of Conservation of our Culture and Heritage. We're going to present a video because a picture's worth a thousand words. Heritage has to do with the Jesuits in Paraguay, particularly Jesus de Tabarangue, and not just with planting trees, but in involving the criteria of sustainability. The important thing is to integrate technology in a 3D light and sound experience. And I'm going to stop so you can listen to the music. You can see Neva's smile. Neva's familiar with this, and she's given us a lot of support on this. She's from the Pilgrim's Way, St. James Pilgrim's Way. We're going to see two. Now, we're supposed to finish up here. This is the most important thing, because I'm going to tell you that for the communities, first of all, we have to convince the local communities to use technology because they have very deeply rooted traditions. If they don't say yes to the technologies that will enable us to show a pathway or a destination, it's not going to happen. So we're talking about another group that has inherited the evangelization and colonization and through the Jesuits. And they incorporate this, and they thank the land for being so fertile, thank God. And they take over the starring role, so to speak. But if they do not incorporate technology into their storytelling, it becomes an imposition, and we can't do that. So the governments have to empower communities. And what does that consist of? First of all, working in what types of technologies? And we have implemented the most important technology and the best technology with the help of the UNESCO in a very small community. And this community is totally empowered. They are embracing this technology. We're talking about history and heritage, but we're also talking about feelings and sentiments when we tell, as they tell their story. So first of all, it has to click in their soul, but not in the brain or imagination. For us, a smart destination is first and foremost empowering the communities. Without integration and without engagement, we will not be able to implement the technology. The local residents become the main players, and the tourists become spectators, spectators of the storytelling that through 3D is capable of bringing to them. So we're incorporating criteria of sustainability, as I said, through tourist inns. And we care for our heritage by taking care of the environment, by planting trees, and above all, working on multi-destination. How are different smart destinations connected through these routes? And Paraguay is undertaking this the connection of these different Jesuit destinations and creating a single product. Thank you very much. I'll ask you a question and to the entire panel. And as you've finished up with the last video, I now have the pleasure of asking Alberto. Indra is a huge company which offers smart city solutions. For us, smart cities and smart destinations have much in common, but there are certain differences. In the city, we have a lot of sensors, and so it's easy for us to obtain information. But in travel, it can be more difficult, where we don't have these traffic sensors or as many sensors for the types of management. So what can Indra tell us about what is needed to create the smart base for smart destinations?
Thank you for the invitation. I'm sorry, but I cannot agree with you. it's like this. There are some cities that don't have lots of sensors because they don't have them nowadays. There are many sensors, like all of us, we carry a smartphone, and that's a very important sensor, for example, for tourism. Through the smartphones, we're sending information on how we move, where we move, when we move. All cities in the shops, they have TPVs, terminals for payments. So that also gives information on the expenditure of tourists, what they like. There also, so that you don't have really. Of course, there are other type of sensors, but most of the cities have access to data nowadays. In a sense, if you ask me about the difference between a smart city or a smart destination, it's to be very, very small. We need to take care of, for example, the impact of tourism on the residents of a city or a territory, because they normally put certain stress on the services of the cities, mainly when the tourism is stational. In summer, the cities in Spain where the population increases 20 or 100 fold. So that really poses a challenge for cities in the sense that they have services like waste management or information to the citizens that are organized for maybe 100,000 people, and in summer or in winter, if it's a ski resort, they receive 1 million people. So that's something that we need to look at. For example, the rest, it depends. Smart cities or smart destination projects have certain issues that you must to have in mind when you start a project like that. The complex projects, they need political vision, they need funding, they need a model of governance. Of course, they need some technological basis, but we try to start with cities and provinces and regions from what they have. Of course, they need to have a certain connectivity capability, some infrastructure. And then we always ask, what are your priorities? Where do you want to go? What are your main problems? And what are the resources that you have? Also, bear in mind that it's not only a question of money, which is very important, but it's also a question of strategy, planning, human resources. These are big projects, and normally municipalities or regions, public administrations, they don't have too many idle people working, so they need normally some support from the partners. So I'd say it's a combination of many things. Let me say that here in Spain, we've been working in a very, that's a lesson I think you can, it's good news that a national network of smart destinations is being created, because we've been working very closely the industry, some companies here represented, together with the public administration at all levels, with the Secretary of State, with the Ministry, with Segitur, of course, but also with the regional governments and local governments, very closely in the development of strategies, but also in very important questions such as norms and standards for data sharing, indicators, etc., which are being developed here in Spain together with the industry and that public administration, and are being adopted as norms by the UTI or ISO, so norms that will structure the future of smart destinations worldwide, and that's very good news.
Thank you very much, and I appreciate it, the disagreement.
It was not very, very tough.
Well, it's exactly where we have to see and to dig out the specialities of why do we focus on smart destinations and not just on smart cities. That is an important part of the reflection we had when preparing for these conferences, when actually providing our audience the insights. And this part is leading me right now to Norway. When we spoke to you, when we spoke to Norway, we were impressed about many things you are doing, especially the huge commitments you have in your policies.
Yes.
And you tend to execute the policies you have promised there, especially in aviation. Some things, I'm curious whether you can make the statement here, how electric aviation will look like in Norway in the year 2040. If you don't feel comfortable with that,
I'll see if I find it. Yeah, there are huge expectations in Norway, and the government has set high goals for the maritime sector, especially because we have so many fjords. And we can read in the newspapers, I saw actually today, new ships are building and they are electric, so that we can manage to take tourism and other people around in the fjords in an electric ferry boats at least. So they set very early a very high standard for the transport sector, and I thought it was already from 2005 they said that they would reduce with 45%.
Bente, allow me one question. I mean, that is maybe especially interesting when you look at these paintings here, the wall, Asturias, and we heard the speeches before, a place in transition. The wealth of Norway was built on what?
Oil.
The wealth you are speaking Norway. About electric?
Yeah, there is a transformation in Norway now. We try to move from the oil and gas sector over to new things that we should live of in the future. And a curiosity is that if you Google in Norway what is the new oil, there is like 16,000 different things coming up. But tourism is one very strong point now. And we are in such a good situation that it's growing in Norway, but it's not growing that fast that we are enabled now to learn to put the systems in advance before we get too much tourists. So we have a system with sustainable destinations, which is quite good, and it's recently become GSDC recognized. And we have 16 destinations gone through that system, where you measure on you have a measurement of 42 measurements and 108 indicators on different levels, both digital and others. Things that makes us more capable of taking on the tourist wave when it comes. We are in the lucky position that there are only a few places where we have over tourism, and we are now in time. We are now putting ourselves ahead so that we can take on more people when it's needed.
Ben, when you lay out these ideas. And you say we still don't have a lot of tourism. Can I ask you the question, sustainability? Is sustainability depending on wealth? Do you have to have wealth to be sustainable as a destination?
Absolutely not. I'm not sure if I understand the question, but the thing we do when we work with the sustainable destination is actually to make a destination leadership. So that we are seeking that we get the local politicians, the people working in the travel industry, and the rest of the industry to co-create and to build the destinations together, so that we can have the right tourists coming in into the different areas of Norway. It has nothing to do with wealth, but we should wealth alone, but we should actually make money on those who come.
Good. And what I wanted to drill on, and that brings me to my next panelist, Hanifam, was actually, do we need money for this technology? Do we need right now, what do we need in infrastructure? In the past, we were limited and we were basically acting upon surveys. Nowadays, we have technology which helps us to understand, to better find out what is actually happening in our destinations. Can I ask you what Mastercard, which was actually in the past a means of payment, what Mastercard right now thinks of destination management?
I don't know if this. Yeah, here we are. So all of you know about Mastercard as a payment company. We establish global standards. We enable the largest number of businesses to connect with consumers, both in the physical world and in the online world, faster than anybody on the planet. We connect more people on the planet. It's why we talk about inclusion, and we started the journey on inclusion, thinking about including people in financial services. You know, one third of the world has no access to basic financial services, which means their ability to travel or even contemplate any notion of tourism doesn't exist at all. And so we took that on as a real challenge, and we committed to bring 500 million people into the formal economy. We're almost there with that, and we're ready to up those targets again. So when you talk about smart tourism and smart destinations, you have to start with some basics. You have to start with the notion of inclusion. Now let me tell you a little bit about the MasterCard you probably don't think very much about. So our ability in terms of creating insights is second to none. And we do it not in isolation, but we do it with partners. So a number of organizations here, including some of my distinguished colleagues and friends here, we have partnerships with. And together, we're able to not only protect the identity of individuals, aggregate data, and produce profound insights that allow us to do three very important things. First of all, and this is relevant to the conversation we've been having so far. First of all, how do we create efficiencies in existing infrastructure? That's really key. The era of raising taxes to make investments is coming to an end around the world. The era of raising taxes to improve public infrastructure in a world where in 30 years, 70% of the population on Earth is going to be living in cities is over. We need to come up with a smarter model. We need to inform not only local economies, not only cities, but the movement of people around the globe with these smart insights. So I'll give you a practical example. In the City of London, partnering with the City of London, we now partner with over 100 cities around the world. We've managed to reduce the cost of mobility in those cities by nearly half, from 15%, which is an astonishing number, down to around about 8 or so. We're doing that in other areas of city life as well, including civic engagement, including mobility point to point, including urban planning, including security and cybersecurity. And we're doing that through both insights and through technology and through clever partnerships. So that's one aspect. If you think about this as a pyramid, the second layer is what is the user experience? When we talk about tourism insights, et cetera, there's a lot of government folks here, there's a lot of industry folks here. But for the end user lives in a world today where they expect real-time data, and they expect not only real-time data, but they expect an understanding of themselves. To give you a practical example, the government of Singapore is in the process of building propensity models at an individual level to think about who they should invite to their country. At the same time, they want to build value scores for every single visitor to the country. This is not an invasion of privacy. It's not even identifying who the person is, but it's building a series of aptitudes and profiles that address both domestic needs and the needs of visitors and optimize the two. So what does the user experience feel like? How do I take the friction out of my journey? Again, let's be very practical. Standards are very important. I'm not a fan. We are not a fan of domestic local standards for anything, whether it's transportation, whether it's infrastructure, whatever it is. Because from a tourism point of view, when people arrive, whether it's from another city or another country, they're paralyzed because they don't understand the local infrastructure. The structure that I use in my hometown, the way I identify myself, the way I communicate, the way I catch public transit should be the same around the world. This is not an impossible task. It's doable, and we're doing it around the world. Practical point number two. Third practical point is it's very easy to invest money in shiny new objects, whether it's a shiny new hotel, whether it's a shiny new hospital, whether it's a shiny new train line. That's not the most efficient thing, and it's not the first thing we have to do. We have to optimize the capacity of what we have. We call that active demand management, and it's just as relevant whether you're talking about the train system in a city or talking about tourism and optimizing tourism. We have to find ways, and we're doing it, of actually optimizing the value, optimizing the yield of what we have in place today. I'll give you a practical example. For those cities, and we've discussed some whose population grows by more than 100%. If you're able to shift in a large city 5% of the mobility movement in public transit at the peak, that has the empirical effect of pushing the capex curve for that city out by 2 years. In a large city like London or New York, that's worth hundreds of millions of dollars in interest savings alone. So
can you just repeat that? 5% shift of demand translates into 2 years
of capex shift. delays in capital expenditure by 2 years. These are very significant points. And when we talk about tourism, when we talk about yield management, which a lot of airlines and hotels talk about, when we talk about resorts, when we talk about public infrastructure, when we talk about the movement of people, particularly at peak times, managing demand through smart technology and through insights and through an intervention model is really profound. Let me make it very practical to show you this is not a theoretical conversation. In the city of Chicago, in the United States, the city worked with us and we created a partnership with a number of technology providers and companies where the city texted people and said, when there's something significant going on, one of the examples was a Cubs game, a baseball game in Chicago, where the city goes into chaos when there's a game. The same thing happens when Real Madrid or Barcelona play football or many other events that go on in the ski season in Norway and other things. And they asked a very simple question. Can we send you a text message and redirect your journey when there's something going on in the city? No incentives, no money, nothing, just a little insight and the ability to communicate in real time. Normally when you run programs like that, you see 2 or 3% of people say yes. We saw 18% behavior modification. 18%. If you translate that.
Honey, I see you in motion. I see you right now stimulated, and I see that you are stimulating others also to speak. Honey, I come back to you. That was really good. Allow me right now to give the ladies to your left the floor, please. We should not. Brigitte, please. Brigitte, the perspectives and what Amadeus has to offer to destinations. Tell us what is so special about Amadeus, what you can offer.
Well, Amadeus, first of all, you know us as a GDS, I guess, and related to air, but today we are much more than this. So we have celebrated our 30th birthday just now, and during the years we expanded. So we are equipping airports with infrastructure, we are equipping hotels, we are working with railway providers, we have the network of travel agencies, be it the big ones like Expedia or Kayak or the traditional agency. So what Amadeus is doing is we are equipping really a big network, connecting all the players that we have. And I think the intelligence of the future is linking the knowledge, the data, and the richness of experience and knowledge of the players to make really a superior solution also for destinations becoming more smart and giving them forecasting, giving them intelligence on what will happen for the future. Of course, you all know what happened in the past, but what interests you is who will come in the future. How can I really react to this? What do I need to do to attract the travelers that I want and not the travelers that I don't want? And just imagine, we have today 4.1 billion air passengers. There are three prognoses of IATA. One is a moderate growth. The second one that we are assuming that will happen is that air flights will double by 2030. And a third one is that it even will triple. So imagine all those passengers flying into destinations like Venice, like Barcelona. How can you cope? I mean, this will be an issue of sustainability. This will be an issue of distributing tourists. And to me, when I started in this new job a few months ago, one of the most impressive things I have seen is that destinations manage from having zero touristic spot a few years ago. Look at Dubai. In 1990, they had nothing. Today, they are a super smart destination. They work with hotels, they work with amusement parks, they work with airlines, they work with the airport to make the experience of a visitor coming to Dubai really a great one. And I think this is where we need to go. And this is where we want to help the industry to go. So concretely what Amadeus does. We have a unit called Amadeus for Destinations. That's my unit. And we are today, this is a starting point, equipping destinations with data on what has happened in the past, what will happen in the future, mainly on air. Of course, this is what is our core. We intend to enrich this with more data, and we provide targeting and marketing capabilities so that you can, for instance, educate travel agencies what to do in a destination. We did this with a Japanese destination that was not known at all to tourists in Europe, and they managed to have really a great response. So we provide our network to destinations to promote their destination. We provide spaces on itineraries, boarding passes to tell, to link passengers on what they can do in destinations. And we have with Travel Audience, our subsidiary company, a truly programmatic advertising company, which we equip with data we have in order to target the visitor that you want. So this is the scope. At the same time, what we are doing in Asia is we have started, and coming what you said, honey, about 70% of the population will live in cities in a few years, and also populations will go up. So those cities will have enormous issues in traffic, pollution, visitors coming. So we have started, especially with Singapore, but also with other cities in Asia, a smart destination project where we work with the airport, where we work with public transportation, where we work with the community we have in Asia, with the government, in order to find technological ways to really make travel experience for all participants a very good one.
Brigitte, thank you very much. Now, with Elisa, we have somebody from a world where patents are important. And Elisa, you are holding two patents. Is this a difficult thing? That was something difficult for you to do? And this preservation of the intellectual rights. Can you just see right now through these lenses into what does it mean for a destination right now to lose control? If we are getting into technology, we are becoming more transparent. Would you see a link between the two? What is the experience you could forward from that perspective?
Okay, yes, I have the ownership of two patents. The two of them was very based on the day-by-day job. So it's the results of the experience, and it's the results of the experience that I had during the Olympic Games in Sydney, and when you need to resolve problems, real problems, okay? When you're thinking about that kind of events, really there are to work with the number of information, with the quantity of information, and also to understand how you are going to be able to provide information in a very short period of time. That means less than seconds. Okay, you need to use the imagination and also to understand very well the technology to make it happen. Okay, and that was the relation of the two patents. So, and also that. This has a link, okay, with things that really happen in the destinations, okay? At the end, my previous colleagues talking about what the information, how much information we have in the cities, what is the information that coming from sensors, what kind of sensors and that kind of things. And at the end, you need to put all of this information in the perspective of the tourists. How you are going to manage the experience of the tourists in the destination. And this is the kind of support that the artificial intelligence can help the destinations, okay, to use the information that is created by the tourist itself during the period of time that the tourist is in the destination. So with the artificial intelligence, you are able to improve the engagement with the tourists. Okay, how you can use the natural language processing to completely reinvent the relationship with the tourists. Okay, how you can use the information that is provided by the tourist itself in the conversation with the destination, how you can use that information in order to improve the personalization. So that's one of the objectives, so one of the areas where the artificial intelligence can use the can help the destinations. The second area could be related with operations. How all of this information, because at the end, when the tourist has one tablet or they have one phone, this is a sensor itself, okay? And the words in this reinvention of the conversation with the tourists, the words that the tourist is using in the conversations means sentiments, for instance, okay? But also means priorities. But and all of this, at the end, you are able to convert all of this in personalization. So you have an opportunity for upsellings, for cross-sellings, okay? And also, why not, to create a new experience based on that information that you receive. And the last one is in related with the knowledge. All of this, all the interactions, all the information that coming from the tourists, all the information that coming for the sensors, all the information that coming for the experience of the people that is working in tourist segment is knowledge. And currently, with the artificial intelligence, you are able to harvest that knowledge. So we are able to achieve one of the aspirational concepts that is the collaborative knowledge. So currently, the artificial intelligence helping you to create this aspirational concept. How you are able to create that knowledge and how you are able to share the knowledge between the different people in your institutions, in your hotels, in your destinations, and how you are able to train people based on that knowledge. So this is the three areas where we think in IBM that the artificial intelligence can help destinations.
Thank you, Elisa. Elena, Telefonica, you are known to have analyzed here in Spain, but also in other countries, tourism flows. What is the latest you can tell us right now what Telefonica is doing in context of tourism destinations?
Thank you. Well, it's clear we were saying that for being smart destinations, we need to use big data, and for use big data, we need data. And it was already commented that there were some kind of data available, but there was another kind of data that was missing in the equation that is what basically a company such as Telefonica, that is a mobile operator, can offer. That is the movements of the flows of population. No? Because as Elisa was mentioning, thanks to this small device is an identifier of the location, but also the profiling and activity of the people. And as a network operation, we process hundreds of millions of events 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And we have developed a platform. We started like 4 years ago, and I'll tell you a little bit later, that basically processes all these data points. We anonymize it because we don't need to know who is behind this point. We just need to know that there is a point with certain characteristics. We extrapolate it and we aggregate it to represent the whole population. And with this information coming from more than 350 million users in the world, we are able to characterize the flows, the movement of the flows of population, where they are coming from, if they are national or international, because they are using roaming, where they live, the overnight that they stay in one place, the different places that they have been to. And with that, we are able to provide with a very powerful visualization and with APIs the information that destinations and the different players in the tourism ecosystem need to take better decisions. Some of the use cases that my colleague from MasterCard was mentioning, understanding what happened in one event before and after, planning infrastructure or transportation, understanding the demand in the different locations, in different destinations, is something that we can help to thanks to our services. You were talking, because I know you know us, that we started maybe 4 years ago and we struggled to see how we can treat the data and especially how we could be useful for destinations. For instance, we started in collaboration with Segitur and it was not easy at the beginning, but now we have something that is already reality and we are working with different destinations in Europe, in Spain, in UK, and in many countries of Latin America, helping the tourism and the travel industry to take better decisions. Now we are evolving, including, for instance, artificial intelligence, making sure that we do and we have better and real-time insights, and that everything that we do can be combined with other kind of insights that the destination has. So we are working basically in making things better, real-time, but especially making sure that out of these inputs, out of these insights, are better decisions in the destination, that this is the objective that Telefónica has with this unit.
Thank you, Elena. This brings me to Andrea, correct? Andrea Voleter, Presidenta de Transforma de Turismo de Chile. Andrea, Transforma Chile. ¿Cuál son vuestros?
What are your plans? What are you out to change, and what do you want to transform and change? Well, in Chile, tourism has been growing significantly in recent years. Today, it accounts for 10% of the country's GDP. And our top challenge here is to ensure that the different authorities, like in many countries, we want them to understand that tourism is a sector, is an industry that is important and that is a significant economic player, factor for our country, which of course we want them to fall in love with tourism. So there's a budget. So Transforma Turismo is a public-private initiative, very highly effective, which has an executive secretariat, and we've laid down a 10-year roadmap. And one of the biggest challenges there is to do digital transformation of the different destinations of digitalization. And we want the authorities to understand the importance of tourism, but we also want different ecosystems, as Natalia mentioned yesterday. We want the different innovation ecosystems and others as well start to think of tourism as an industry in which investment is worthwhile. We've listened to big companies here that today talk about tourism. They develop products. With Telefónica, we had a good experience with Telefónica working with mobility. Because the data is there, the information is there. We're all wondering about the use of surveys. They're obsolete, they're expensive, takes a long time to develop. But it also turns out, what we're finding that data is there, but it's not accessible. Today, from a budgetary point of view, again, we find that Telefónica has the data, but we need the budget. We need a budget because without it, we cannot progress. There's a brick wall in front of us right now from this point of view. So we're hoping in the future data and technology will be made available to the different players, to the different destinations. And then we find when we go to specific destinations, what we're finding is that, again, technology is there, data is there, but it all ends with people because it's the people that develop, that make destinations happen. that and someone mentioned the panel, it's the people that have to build. We have to work together, public and private, have to work together, hand in hand, to close the technological gap. In all our countries, tourism is made up mostly of small of SMEs. 95% of the companies, the tourist companies, are SMEs. So the technological gap that we have in our country is huge. For that purpose, we set up two programs. We have two centers. They're present in this Congress because we want to. We've come here to learn. And it's basically of helping and supporting companies so that they can close that technological gap. Because, of course, big speeches are great, but we really have to take them by the hand so they can come out of that technological weakness that they have. So that's transformaturismo, the challenges for Chile. Thank you.
The end of the first statements, and right now I would like you to, whenever you feel that this answer, that this question is of relevance and that you have something to contribute, that you just raise your hand and we have a dialogue on that. We spoke about right now the different perspectives of intelligent destinations and the contributions technology have to that. My first question would right now be, the success of tourism in recent years had in some destinations provoked that we had a discussion of bad management of tourism. That should be for us all in the tourism sector the big warning. But it means something different in the different contexts of indigenous people, of somebody opting right now for digitalization, of destinations which are easily equipped with sensors and information, and others which have not this infrastructure. What would you prioritize from your individual perspective to ensure that we understand the locals, that we engage in a participatory approach so that they can express the desired tourism development? Who wishes to take the floor first on that? Perfect.
I want to stay in the theme of practical to your question. So I think two very important things. First of all, identity. And identity does not mean an invasion of privacy for people. People are very sensitive to identity. That's one. That's a really key topic. And I'll use a different word than identity. I'll use the word persistent authentication. Technology is available for us to do that today, number one. Number two, be very respectful of the information that people share with you. It's not free and it's not yours to do as you wish with. We've heard a lot of conversations today about where information is available. We are moving towards a world, and I think, and I applaud efforts like GDPR, where the information that I share, I want to understand where it lives and where it's going and how it's being used forever. And I think technologies like blockchain will allow us to do that very thoughtfully going forward. Most people don't think about blockchain and information exchange. You should. The third is around standards. Please do not adopt local standards just because you can. Adopt international standards, otherwise you will alienate the tourists that come to your destinations. Those three things will allow you to speak from a civic engagement point of view to the people locally that live in your communities and elicit their views about tourism, as well as to the international community.
Bente, please.
It's important to take care of the locals. If the locals are not included in the planning process, they will feel distance to the visitors, and then we are in a mismatch already. So, practical again, it's important to include them in the planning, and one way you can do it is that, for instance, my responsibility is to market Norway abroad, and what I do say here must be in the same context at what, how we develop the products. So that if I market Norway as a peaceful destination in the fjords where you can do this and that, that must get along with the product development. And the product development must be a planning with the local people so that we have the possibility to influence in the whole journey of the tourist and also in the whole experience for the locals. We need to draw the local into the circle of the tourists.
Thank you very much. And next one, Elisa, right? Then we have Elena, then the Secretary of State, then Paraguay, Indra.
Okay, so, and taking account this local, okay? The other that I think is relevant is to have an ecosystem in the local level to create the ecosystem with a very collaborative feeling or behavior between the different actors, including the technology. Currently, the technology is in the hands of everyone, okay? With the new cloud models, with the new ways that the technology companies, we are deliver the technology is in the hands of the people. So working in local with a local collaborative garage, innovation space, whatever, is very relevant to really to make the change and to be able to cross the boundaries between the sector and the technology. And I think this is another concept to take into account.
Just complimenting and building on the other comments, because I think they were all very valid. I just want to say that democratization of tourism is clearly good, especially for the travel and tourism industry, but it's true that it's also creating over-tourism, and this is where we need to involve the locals, because otherwise you are getting negative reactions. I think this is accelerating the need of being smart and even to use data and big data, of course, to better manage demand, inventory, and offering, to have smarter pricing so that we are able to control how the demand is coming and where. So I think this kind of sustainable tourism, that is something a reality, and here in Spain we have clear experiences of that, is accelerating the need of big data to make sure that we take the right decision, that we detect, for instance, untapped opportunities, and we are able to transfer some of the tourism to different seasons, etc. So collaborating with the public and private institutions, I think we have everything we need to really make more sustainable, and I think this is critical.
Thank you, Elena. Secretary. ¿Usted quería intervenir?
Sí, sobre lo que es.
With respect to what's being commented on now, and I mentioned this at the beginning, I think the participation of locals is very important. It's important in decision making so that the tourism is inclusive, to make tourism sustainable, as well as to being able to participate in the redistribution of wealth, which this very important industry generates. And in this sense, technology, as in this entire process, plays a very key role. Now more than ever, or particularly at this time, this public private with businessmen as well as local residents is very important. And technologies can help and will help and will make it possible for this to be the case. I agree with all of our friends here up on stage. Empowering the locals is fundamental in Paraguay. This has been very important. To implement a technology, we have to first empower the communities. Technology is the path or the means by which they are able to show themselves, tell their stories, their culture, and it's essential. It also optimizes the experience for the end user, the tourist. In today's world, where we are humanizing tourism, technology, of course, is the key to be able to show ourselves as we are. But the most important thing I think that we need to talk about when we're talking about 2030 is how technology can measure sustainability criteria, and particularly to be able to attract the tourist. A smart destination or a smart city with a sustainability criteria but doesn't have the tourist's soul is not a tourist destination.
It is also very important to approach tourism with a holistic approach, because it takes place in a territory with people, so it's not something that is isolated. So it needs to be thought and designed and managed, taking into account mobility, sustainability, environment, security, many things. So that's, in our view, the approach that must be taken, a holistic approach in a technological words. That means it is a good thing to have a platform, an intelligent, smart platform, to be able to manage not just tourism, which is very complex, but also put together the data and knowledge from other areas of the city. For example, it is important to know what is the impact of 1,000 tourists coming in a cruise in Malaga on the waste management service of the port, or what's the impact, or be able to predict or the effect of meteorology or the climate on the tourist, because if it's, for example, it's going to be very hot, the tourist can be alerted of that. And for that, you need a piece of technology that is capable of having IoT, big data for analytics, social media analysis, artificial intelligence or machine learning, etc. And nowadays there are some solutions for that we are using in already in some projects in Spain, like Las Palmas, the Gran Canaria, Cáceres, etc., which are very interesting to be known.
Thank you, Alberto. And right now we focus, please, on one last question, one line of thought. I would like to hear from you right now, after having heard from you that we increase efficiency, that we have a better understanding what is happening in destinations, that taxes no longer can be raised, that resources are used in a different manner. And we are discussing this here as participants of a tourism event. An event on tourism. Do you feel right now that the tourism sector is interested, is pushing a discussion of governance in destinations? Would you concur with that? Do you think that the tourism sector's discussion currently is influencing societies and transforming the way of governance? Please.
I think the answer is yes, for two reasons. First of all, tourism over the last 10 years has grown faster than worldwide GDP. So there's a disproportionate shift in the impact of tourism on the worldwide economy and the health of the worldwide economy. I think tourism is playing an increasingly important role in geopolitics and better understanding across cultures and across destinations. For our future survival, for our future sustainability, for our future human evolution, that's really critical. I think tourism is tapped into technology and is dependent on technology in a profound way. And we are seeing that come together through wonderful organizations like UNWTO, working on these big topics, some of which we've discussed today, like identity, like security, etc. That's a wonderful way for the tourism industry to come together and influence through these very significant bodies, both at the global and at the local level. So I think the answer is absolutely yes. I also think that the expectation of people around the world of the tourism industry is changing. And last but not least, the tourism industry is an integral part of the communities we live in. We talked a lot today about cities, which is a funny thing maybe 10 years ago to have spoken about in the context of tourism. But the future evolution of cities, demand management, as you said, the ability for people in cities to influence tourism, the ability for tourism operators to coexist with cities, never been more critical than today. And it's an inescapable connection between the two. And it can't be done in isolation by any one city, state, private sector actor, or anybody else. This requires a new model of collaboration and a new model of partnership.
Yes, please.
I agree as well. What I believe is that we are at a tipping point with new technologies to come. So today we are sitting on a bench of data, but deriving the intelligence, combining the data, using artificial intelligence, using biometric data, I think we can do much more together. And for us, it's a critical moment in the next 4 to 5 years to come to really cope with what comes in terms of new tourism. Otherwise, we will have the incidents like we are suffering from over-tourism. We have neighborhoods complaining, never wanting more tourists and thinking about what the contribution is to our jobs, to the economy. That's huge. I mean, I think it's really now the time to exploit new technologies, to work together in partnerships, and this organization can play a key role, UNWTO, in linking us all together and in is helping the participants in that room to really make this future happen.
Thank you. Elena, please.
I'm going to be optimistic as well. I'm going to say yes. I had a chance to participate in last year's conference in Murcia, and I can see that there are things that have changed and have evolved during this year. The first thing is the degree of consciousness that this is for real, that this is the only way to go. And the second one is that we have real cases of destinations that are improving and are using data. So I think the evolution is positive. But there is a long, long way to go. And there is no time to lose. So yes, it's evolving, but we still need to do many things. And as it has been already said, it needs to be a cooperative effort, not just in isolation.
That's a good statement. I would invite the last three statements so that we stay somehow in time. Please, Andrea.
Cuando estamos hablando en un mundo...
When we're talking about a world with such tremendous technological change, and we're talking about employment, and we see how there are certain sectors in which jobs will be decreased, we can see how technology applied to tourism will help us to grow, support, and optimize our destinations. There are destinations, at least in South America, there. Development depends on tourism. It's not just digitalization, but this is very important so that these destinations will develop as best they can for the future. Elisa, I see that you're taking notes. Are you going to intervene? I fully agree with what my colleagues have said. The only thing I would like
the tourist industry is growing, and this is a fact. And but also it's changing. So we are what I am seeing in my day by day working with the destination is that they are looking for the experience. They are looking for to understand really how to create new experience for the tourists. And in order to do that, we need to work together
with the digitalization, okay, to really to create this experience. So it's not only growing, it's also changing, and we need to follow the change.
Anybody else? Yes, Minister, please, yes.
I didn't want to miss out on the opportunity. Like Chile, we're both from South America. Our the challenge is European markets. We have very different realities. Africa is very different and faces other problems and issues. So we're talking about how to work on the supply side, intelligent or smart supply. I would like to say that the next conference, why not talk about smart connectiveness when in South America we developed this, because tourism may be losing its strength in terms of government policy. If we can attract tourists to these areas where we have worked the smart destination projects or smart cities, then I think that formula will be a good one. So I would like to say that we're all starting from very different realities. There's much of Latin America is not connected one to another within Latin America. Europe is totally connected. And so in my country, it's a problem, and it's a problem similar to what Chile also suffers. Throughout Chile, connectivity is a huge, huge challenge. So we have to awaken the smart technology for connectivity, but smart connectivity by means of technology. Thank you. Yes, the world of tourism, the industry, is undergoing total and very rapid change. Our new technologies, the implementation of technological processes throughout the throughout management is key, so that this path that we are walking will redistribute wealth, improve our destinations, and to communicate. I totally agree in that regard, as well as to manage very different realities. And I think this can also help, because it's not easy. Certain destinations have nothing to do with others. And I think with technology and the implementation of these new tourism management models, I think all of us will win if we go hand in hand with all of the stakeholders involved. I don't think this is a trend. It is the future. And we're going to work hard on the national level, in my case, and that I understand that with the collaboration of all stakeholders involved, public and private. And of course, all of the different regions and destinations around the world. Thank you very much.
This high-level smart talk, we are coming to an end. Enjoy the rest of the conference. You please enjoy the panelists whenever you can. Thank you very much. Muchas gracias. Muchas gracias.
Ladies and gentlemen, coffee is now served just outside the door here. Can we please ask you to return to here, to room number one, as soon as you have had your coffee so we can catch up a little bit of time. The clock is now ticking. Thank you so much.
Not an easy task.